Thank you. Thank you. Well, and thank you to those of you who are joining us on the webcast. I've got a little smiley face above the camera to make sure I occasionally remember to say hi to you again and during the talk. But sorry you can't join us for the pizza, but I'm very glad you're joining us for the actual conversation here. And just for those of you who are local, just I had a few minutes to walk around your campus, and I had a little drive around the campus, and it is beautiful. It really is, and it's spring here, and everything's coming out and blossoming, and it's a very warm day. So a very nice start to the event from my point of view, and really enjoyed it. And I'm just very grateful for this opportunity to talk about Mary Baker Eddy and her legacy. I've been one of the beneficiaries of it for well over 3 decades now. And I want to start, actually, by taking us back a month to what was mentioned by Jenny just now, and that is the themes, actually, of National Women's History Month and also International Women's Day. Because if you'll notice, there's a little bit of commonality between the two. You've got National Women's History Month here in the USA was talking about trailblazing women, and then International Women's Day was talking about being bold for change. And trailblazing, being bold, they're really one of a kind, aren't they? It's just about that desire to do something that will make a difference and being willing to go out and do it. And we're going to be talking about a woman today who really does fit both those titles of trailblazer and being bold for change. And she was impelled, really, by a desire to understand the things of spirit and their practicality. And it was that desire to understand the things of spirit and prove their practicality that was really a thread weaving her way through much of her life. And fortunately, it bore fruit. And I, as I said, am one of the beneficiaries of the fact that there is a healing practice available now that Mary Baker Eddy introduced through her understanding of the scriptures, and particularly the example of Christ Jesus. And I want to actually introduce her to you. I want to introduce her to you by introducing you to a book that was written actually by a Jewish scholar called Jacob Neusner. And this guy deserves a lecture of his own. He wrote and or edited 950 books before he passed on last year. And I can't even get my head around that. That's so impressive, so amazing. But the other thing that impressed me about Jacob Neusner is I read his little summary of Mary Baker Eddy's impact, and it really captures the spirit, the essence of Mary Baker Eddy's trailblazing and her boldness for change really well. And so I'm going to read it to you, but it says America up there. I'm from Britain, as you can see. And what I've done is I've translated the phrase America to the globe and the world, because everything he says about America really would apply to, from my point of view anyway, I would say it would apply to the world. And so here goes. This is, whoops. What Mary Baker Eddy did was directly and emphatically challenge the status quo of global culture in both her religious teachings and in their practical application. She called into question the authority of two of the world's most venerable institutions, religion and medicine. In matters of religion, she challenged both male dominance and the social power of male-dominated religions. In matters of medicine, she challenged the belief that medical institutions have a monopoly on healing. And last but not least, more fundamentally, Mary Baker Eddy challenged one of the most primary presuppositions of the modern Western secular West, the material basis of reality. Does that sound bold? Does that sound trailblazing? And the amazing thing is, you know, this was a time Mary Baker Eddy lived in, as Most of you probably realize it was the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century when women were not really even welcome in the workplace, let alone to be talking about issues like science, theology, and medicine. I think one thing I would like to say, though, is this sounds as if she was challenging the institutions. And it really wasn't the institutions Mary Baker Eddy was ever challenging. She always had a great respect for people with differing views. But she was challenging the views. And the thing that was most radical about her, really, was the ideas that she shared. But one of the things that I would put it this way, she was in effect saying to what you might call modern, male bastions of the time, male thought bastions, science, theology, and medicine, she was literally saying, look, I think we've got it upside down, and that I think that the modes of science, theology, and medicine can bring us a spiritual understanding which shows us how to change our thoughts and change our lives as a result of it. And I think in some of the secular conversations we have today, that would still be kind of radical. But the other thing that would be very unusual to a lot of thinkers today is that although she took on these major themes, her main textbook for doing so was the Bible, the scriptures. And there may be people on the webcast or even here who perhaps don't have a sense of the Bible as something very positive. And I totally identify with that because in my late teens and early 20s, I didn't. I thought of the Bible as a book of dogmas and doctrines and of restrictive rules. And I know there are a lot of people out there, particularly from my country, we seem to be exporting this view quite a lot for some reason, people who even believe that the Bible is a book of fairy tales. And I, again, respect everyone's perspective as they're going through life. As one whom his mother comforteth, so will I comfort you. That's from the Hebrew scriptures, the book of Isaiah. And this is a terrific way to think about God. You know, again, if we've got this view of God as judgmental and critical and always upset with us, this is totally the opposite. This is a God who loves us, embraces us, supports us, guides us, is there for us, with us. And that's how I feel I've learned that God is, a God of comfort and love to support and guide. And then in the New Testament, Jesus said, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. And when we're talking about Christian Science, which is what we are talking about in relation to Mary Baker Eddy, that was her discovery, Jesus is the rock of Christian Science, just like for all Christianity. This is where we go to see really the best expression ever of the nature of God, what God is really like. Now, this particular Bible passage is often seen by people as being a promise that Jesus himself will at some time return in person to bring us this sense of comfort. But what if it meant something a bit more promising than something that's still a way off? What if Jesus was actually saying that the very comfort people felt from his love that brought them healing would not disappear when he was no longer present here? That there was a continuity to that healing love. And what if that second part, I will come to you, was not so much talking about the return of Jesus in person, but talking about the return of the very ideas and understanding of the divine and of our relation to the divine, which enabled him and empowered him to do that healing? What if it was a prophecy that at some point someone would actually seek out, discern, or discover, demonstrate and articulate how it was that he himself was able to heal in the way he did? So that not only comfort, but what Jesus called the Comforter would be available in order to bring healing and to give us the power to wrestle with those things in our lives, those challenges that need us to be transformed for our own sakes and for the sakes of others. Well, some of you might be familiar with the word comforter, some of you might not. It's in the King James Version, that's the way a particular word is translated. In some other translations, it's different. But Jesus himself described what he meant by the comforter. He said, "The comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you." Bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. And again, as a Christian Scientist, I would say that's exactly what Christian Science has done for me and many, many, many others. It has not only brought to our remembrance what Jesus said, it's also brought to our remembrance the amazing things that Jesus did. And it's also brought to us an understanding of what all that means to us, of the spiritual meaning of that, and of how that points to the healing that was actually at the heart of his ministry. And when we're talking about Mary's practical legacy, there are many, many things we can point at. But one of the things she did, which was so helpful, was she combed the Bible for an understanding of how that healing that was recorded in the Bible was done. And that went not only throughout the New Testament, but even through the Hebrew Scriptures. There's so much healing. And what she found was how the Bible still contains the recipe, if you like, for that healing, still today. And I like how a friend of mine called Thomas put it. He said, "Some people, when they see a box with black and white keys, think of it, well, some people seeing a piano will think of it as a box with black and white keys. Other people will look at it and they will see music. And Beethoven was one of those people." And she said, "Some people looking at this book will see a book of black and white dogmas and doctrines and restrictive rules. But one person looked at it and saw a divine science. That person was Mary Baker Eddy." And when Thomas was talking about a divine science, he was talking about science with a capital S. And it's capitalized because it is a systematic understanding of the divine nature and of the nature of the relation that we all have to the divine. So that's why it is a divine science. But why is it a divine science? Well, it is a science because it is a explanation and understanding of the very nature of reality. And it's an explanation and understanding that doesn't say, "Just believe me through faith." It says, "This is something you can take into the laboratory of your life and you can prove for yourself, step by step, in your experience." Part of that will be physical healing, maybe healing of mental illness. But it also applies to every aspect of our lives, our relationships, what we care about in the world, the things we want to see changed. This is all applicable. This science is applicable to all those things that might be in our thoughts and in our hearts. So this dear lady, Mary Baker Eddy, had quite a journey of her own in order to get to the point where she discovered this divine science. And I'm going to put this heading up, Overcoming Obstacles. Her life was not neatly divided into two halves, but there was a pivotal moment between two halves of her life, which was pretty neat. And I'm going to talk about that moment, but I want to just introduce it by saying, for a long time, Mary Baker Eddy had needs of her own that weren't being met. And she was, like many people today, a seeker for truth. And she was seeking in two ways. She was trying to meet her physical needs through allopathy, homeopathy, other alternatives. And in a way, she was taking the approach of a scientist, really exploring, trying to understand how these might work, not only on the level of physiology, but how the mental factors related to believing in drugs, expecting them to heal, could have an impact on the outcome. But then she was a spiritual seeker who was looking deeply into the scriptures, as we said earlier, for answers as to how the healing had happened before and how it could continue to happen today. And all this kind of came together at one particular point where she had had an accident which looked like it was going to be fatal. There were people gathered in a room really waiting to grieve. And at that point, she did something that was incredibly natural for her. She asked for a copy of her Bible. And she opened it to the Gospels, and she read one of the very familiar healings of Jesus. And by that I mean she was very familiar with it. I know today not everyone is familiar with the content of the Bible, but it was something she knew about and loved. But this time when she read it, in this hour of the deepest need she had yet been in, she caught a glimpse of something that changed her experience in that moment and opened the doorway to begin to put into practice in a systematic way something she had been researching for 20 years, which was to understand the relationship of mind and body, and above all to understand how spiritualizing that mental space, if you like, could bring about healing. So I want to share the glimpse that she said she had in that moment of need. She said, talking about that moment when she was restored to health, she said that short experience included a glimpse of the great fact that I have since tried to make plain to others, namely life in and of spirit, this life being the sole reality of existence. I love the fact she calls it just a glimpse. Sometimes when we have spiritual needs, we think we need a mountain of inspiration. And of course, she was standing on a mountain of study and research and prayer and communion with God. But in that moment, a glimpse was enough. What was important was what she glimpsed. And that is radical and that is beautiful. She glimpsed life in and of spirit. This life being the sole reality of existence. This life being the sole reality of existence. So she glimpsed that at the end of the day, as material as our lives seem to be to us day by day, that material perspective she saw was actually a limited misapprehension of a truer existence, a deeper divine existence, which we really all are part and parcel of. We are individual expressions of the divine. And at that moment, she glimpsed that so clearly that it not only made her feel spiritually clearer and uplifted, but it actually had that impact of changing the discord of her situation into the harmony of a restoration to health. And what she really saw was that healing is about a transformation of thought, a change of our perspective from a material point of view to a spiritual point of view. And I like to illustrate it with a couple of photographs. This is a rather strange photograph because it's a boat surrounded by flowers rather than flower surrounded by water. But I think you'll agree, it's a beautiful photo of a boat surrounded by flowers. But if you come from the city in the north of England where that photo was taken, you'll know that you're missing out on a whole lot. Because when the mist lifts, there's a castle, there's a beautiful hill, there's a beautiful village, and that blue waterway, which is really only blue because the sky's blue, but that's what you're missing. Now, no one needed to put the castle or the village or the waterway there when the mist lifted. They were always there. And in a way, what Mary Baker Eddy glimpsed was this understanding that the health, the harmony, the good we're looking for in our lives is always there. But this miss, this mistaken material perspective that we seem to have and get so familiar with, is hiding what we're really wanting to see from our view. And then the key question is, how do we lift the mist? And that's where she wanted to understand the relationship between mind and body. And as I said, she had a healing. She'd been doing a lot of research into both these healthcare approaches and into the scriptures, she says, for about 20 years before that. And then she kept researching it afterwards. The reason this lecture is called 150 Years of Practical Spirituality is it's just over 150 years ago that she had that particular healing. But it was the whole of that kind of year, really, that she probably would have called the year of discovery. As I said, the research went up to that year, but she pinpoints the end of the year as the moment when she could suddenly look back and say, I have made a discovery. This is how she voiced it. She said, during 20 years prior to my discovery, I had been trying to trace all physical effects to a mental cause. And in the latter part of 1866, I gained the scientific certainty that all causation was mind and every effect a mental phenomenon. All causation was mind, that's with a capital M. So in Science and Health with Keita Scriptures, and I should have shown you these earlier really, the Holy Bible and Science and Health, everything I'm talking about is based on these two books. And Science and Health itself is very much based on, as we said, the science, the divine science in the Bible. But in Science and Health particular, Mary Baker Eddy pinpoints seven particularly helpful synonyms. There are many, many more for God. And life, truth, love, and spirit are synonyms that you will find in the Bible itself. And then she also uses the synonyms divine principle, divine soul, and divine mind, which are not explicitly in the Bible, but are implicitly in the Bible. And I particularly find the synonym of mind useful because it's telling us that God is the divine mind, the source of thought and wisdom and intuition and inspiration and understanding and insights. In this day and age, the common belief is that mind is something in a material brain, that it's a physiological thing rather than a consciousness, a spiritual consciousness. And I love the discussions about whether there's consciousness or not and whether it's generated by the brain or not. People are really grappling with those questions, and I think it's wonderful to see that. But the understanding that I've been getting from studying the Bible and Science and Health is that consciousness truly, really is the substance of our nature. And it is this spiritual consciousness that emanates from the divine, from God. And Mary Baker Eddy, on the basis of this discovery, had an incredible healing practice of her own. And she then went on to teach healing to others based on this being systematic, a science, and therefore something that could be learned. But other ways she proved her theory true, if you want to call it a theory, was not only that she was able to heal and also help people with what the Bible calls sin, those wrestlings we have with those character traits that seem so stubborn within us, but she also, as we said, in that age when women were not really welcome in the workplace and certainly not allowed in the pulpit, she went on to found a publishing society, a business that's still going after well over 100 years, a world-class newspaper, as we heard from Jenny earlier, that's still going strong after well over 100 years, and a worldwide Christian movement, the Christian Science movement, that is a church that is still going after well over 100 years. And she did that without any independent wealth of her own. And she did it, she would be the first one to say, she did it by leaning on God, God was her strength. God was her source of her ability. And in a sense, you could call that humility and meekness. But it was also might. And I think right through the Bible, you will see that theme of humility and meekness leading to mighty activities. Moses is a great example. The Bible calls him the meekest man on earth. And he led 500,000 screaming brats for 40 years across the wilderness and managed to get them to where they were meant to go. And it should have been a lot quicker, but there was a lot of opposition, a lot of resistance. And in the same way, Mary Baker Eddy faced a lot of obstacles, a lot of opposition, a lot of resistance. But she persevered, and she was able to bring to light, as I said, all these things that are still here today to help and support anyone interested in discovering and learning how to heal on this basis of divine science. And I want to talk a little bit more about Mrs. Eddy's humility, because there's a wonderful way she described all her accomplishments, and I've given you such a potted version of what she accomplished. I mean, there are biographies, and we're going to give you a list at the end. You can look up some of her biographies where you will just see, I could give you an hour-long lecture about probably any day in her life. There was so much going on, and it was all to benefit humanity. She always had that orientation of doing what she did to benefit mankind. She never limited it to a little group of people. She was always looking beyond the borders of her own followers. It included her followers. She loved her followers. She loved all Christians, but it didn't stop there. She just embraced all humanity. But how did she do it? Well, this is how she said she did it. All I have ever accomplished has been done by getting Mary out of the way and letting God be reflected. All I have ever accomplished has been done by getting Mary out of the way and letting God be reflected. And that humility is something that we ourselves can look at and embrace. I've sometimes said to myself, why shouldn't we put our own name in there and say, all I ever will accomplish shall be done by getting your name out of here? You don't have to change that if your name is Mary, but if you've got any other name, you have to put your name in there. All you will ever accomplish will be done by getting yourself out of the way and letting God be reflected. And when I say yourself here, I don't mean your individuality. As a child of God, as an idea of that divine mind, your individuality is absolutely precious. We don't want to lose that or lose sight of it. But yourself is this selfhood that believes it's stuck in this material narrative that it can't seem to get out of, which is sometimes happiness, sometimes health, and sometimes not, and sometimes a nightmare. But that's really not the true narrative of our lives. The true narrative of our lives is life in and of spirit, this life being the sole reality of existence. And that discovery of Mary Baker Eddy, she proved very practical, as we said. And I like it. One of my friends once said that what she felt that Mary Baker Eddy did was she resurrected the practice of Christian healing and made it available to the world. She resurrected the practice of Christian healing and made it available to the world. And I just want to go back to that healing moment that we just echoed again. Just to say, I mentioned Moses and his mission. I think one of the commonalities I love between Moses and Mary Baker Eddy is that Moses had a transition from a really quiet life as a shepherd to, as I said, helping the children of Israel get to the promised land. There was a wonderful transition within that where he, according to the Bible, saw a bush that was burning with flames, but the flames were not burning the bush. And it caught his attention, and he stopped to ask what was going on. And at that moment, he had this real clear experience of God. And he saw the nature of God in a new light. He saw God being the great I am, the only I am, the only true ego, of all of us, that one mind, you could say. And that propelled and compelled him to do what he did. And it also gave us a whole new understanding of God that has gone down the millennia since and been incredibly helpful. And Mary Baker Eddy, when she was alone in that room, she had that very similar experience of a new sense of God, which has then been very helpful to many. And the Bible talks about Moses being like someone. Moses spoke to God face to face, like a friend. And that's a slight paraphrase, but that's basically the two words it uses, a face-to-face and a friend. And that's how I like to think of that moment for Mary Baker Eddy as well. It's that intimacy she had of really becoming so conscious of God's presence and love that she understood God in that new way and went forward as she actually had already been going forward with that sense of God as a real presence, a real friend and support, which was the enabler for her mission. So what does a resurrected practice of Christian healing look like? I'm going to be talking about two healings which illustrate the way that Christian Science works in practice. And one of the things I want to go back to is that picture of the mist lifting. Because what is the mist that needs to be lifted for a healing? What is it that will unveil that health and harmony and goodness that we're saying is always there, but we're maybe not seeing it as we should? Well, this is one way it's described in Science and Health. It is our ignorance of God, the divine principle, which produces apparent discord, and the right understanding of Him restores harmony. So the mist that is being lifted is a mistaken sense of deity. No one is disconnected from God for a moment. We're all at one with our Creator. No one ever escapes being the apple of God's eye. God loves each one of us equally, impartially, without interruption, without ceasing. But we have to become aware of that love, like these great Bible figures did, and like Mary Baker Eddy did that night. And we actually have the ability to do that. We each have the spiritual capacity to do that. So I want to share a healing of a mental illness to start with. And it was a healing of a clinically diagnosed depression. And it's kind of not what you do with Hollywood movies. I'm going to show you the end at the beginning, right? So this is it's a woman from Chicago called Patricia. And she said this, looking back at the healing. It was the recognition of a familiar innocence that blazed through the material sense of darkness to open my troubled heart to the light already within. It was a recognition of a familiar innocence. It's natural to feel innocent. It's natural to feel good. It's natural to feel love. And it blazed through what? That mist, that material sense of darkness, to open my troubled heart. And anyone who's had depression or worked with anyone who's had depression will know that is a troubled heart. But opened it to what? Not to the light out there that had to be found, but to the light already within. And to me, this is a beautiful summation of a healing. And it is also a beautiful indication of how Christ heals. And when we're talking about Christ here, I'm not talking about the person of Jesus. I'm talking about that spirit of love and understanding and insight and spiritual strength that animated him. And the Bible talks about the ever-presence of this Christ. It says, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and today and forever. And you have to say, looking at this, is it really saying that Jesus himself is here? yesterday, today, and forever? Well, I think as I read the Bible, what I see is that Jesus was crucified and he was resurrected and then he ascended. He went beyond the material sense of those few people who knew him and loved him and that were with him at that time. And that remains the case. But the Christ, the spiritual activity of God that heals, that he showed us forever. And it was there before Jesus. And it was there, has been there since Jesus. But Jesus is the point where we most clearly see the Christ, the expression of that divine nature. There's another way that Mary Baker Eddy describes this ongoing actuality of the Christ and its availability. In a message to her church, she once said, "Is there more than one Christ? And hath Christ a second appearing? There is but one Christ. And from everlasting to everlasting, this Christ is never absent. The healing Christ is here with us in this room this evening. The healing Christ will be with you when you go home this evening. And you know what? The Christ was there with you in your moment of need and will be in every moment of need. But what the science of the Christ does is it enables us to know that and become conscious of it and aware of it in the most wonderful way." Well, let me illustrate that, as I said, by Patricia's healing. Patricia is now a very joyful 30-something professional from Chicago, and she has a wonderful habit of ending up in conversations with total strangers, whether she's at home in her home city of Chicago or traveling the world with her husband, which they love to do. But you wouldn't have known that if you knew her when she was at high school. She had a deep, deep sadness and a really deep darkness, so much so that she was taken to a psychiatrist and she was diagnosed with, it's a form of depression, I've just forgotten the name, manic depression. And she was put on a course of drugs, and unfortunately in her case, those drugs tipped her over the threshold and she became suicidal, whereas before her depression had not been suicidal. And then one way she tried to gain control was through an eating disorder. That's not what she thought it was at the time, but she knows now it was an eating disorder. The other way was to do a lot of drinking, and she was still a teen, as I said. And for a moment or two, that gave her a sense of control, but then it just made her even worse until she reached what she called rock bottom. But when she reached rock bottom, something wonderful happened. And she had no sense in her life, either when she first had the depression or at this point in the depression, of God. Or she wasn't on any particular spiritual journey. But she had a moment that she called a window moment, where a window opened on this darkness and a real pure light flooded in. It was a sense of real peace, and it was also a sense of being really loved. And the way she described it was a sense of light, just this light coming in through the window. Unfortunately, after a little while, the window slammed shut again, and she was back in the darkness. But there was one difference. She had a spiritual benchmark. She knew she wanted to experience that light again. She knew she wanted to feel that peace again. She knew she wanted to experience that love again. And one other quality she related was a sense of wisdom at that time. And anyway, her wish was granted. She met someone who she found just had a disposition that really inspired her. And also, this person shared some ideas that really, you know, made her think in a good way. And that led her to a copy of Science and Health with Keith's Scriptures, which she not only opened, but she started reading from cover to cover. And she experienced at that point, again, this wonderful sense of just light. She said the whole room felt like it was filled with light as she read Science and Health. And she said it was a moment where it was just like in the Bible stories, where people had that sense of this sudden awareness of the presence of God and the reality of God. And that led her step to step to what she called a sifting process. She felt everything was being sifted. And that again is a wonderful description of what the Christ does for us. It sifts everything within us. But the way Christian Science brings to light that sense of what the Christ does is, yes, it sifts the problems, the character problems we are struggling with, as I said earlier, the sins, as the Bible puts it, but it doesn't do it by telling you are a sinner. It does it by helping to bring to light the fact that you are spiritually innocent, that you're created by God to be innocent and pure. And you begin to sift things by looking back and not saying, oh no, how terrible I was, but saying, God was there. And the challenge when I did the wrong thing and made those mistakes, or the problem when I was suffering and it seemed like there wasn't any solution, those were not God's blueprint for any one of us. That was not God's will. And as you see that in that new light, these things lose their hold over our thoughts. And as they lose the hold over our thoughts, they lose their hold in our experience. And so she was being sifted, but it was a positive thing. It was a great thing. It was a wonderful thing. And we all need that. I mean, I still need that. It's an ongoing process. But when something is sifted through science, what I found is it's gone. It's gone for good. And you can move on to the other things that need sifting. Step by step, we can experience what really the Bible calls salvation, that recognition and that proof that we really are the sons and daughters of God, that from God's perspective, we really are the glorification of all that God is. We reflect the very nature of God. And that was what Jesus showed us so clearly. And that is what Patricia came to see, that she was that child of God. And as she did, that depression totally lifted. She talked about the weight of the depression being replaced by this sense of buoyancy. And of course, she went back, as we saw at the beginning, to that sense of light, this light pouring forth. And that's a long, long time ago. It's never returned. And as I said, she's living the joy in ways that benefit and bless so many other people. And I think that's also another important point about healing in Christian Science. I've been asked occasionally, well, isn't it selfish that you think that God's love should heal you? But the point is, it's like Mrs. Eddy said about all your accomplishments being when you get yourself out of the way and let God be reflected. The healing comes in a package which makes you more loving, more patient, more forgiving, more joyful. You cannot separate it from caring for others and caring for the world, which is why it is Christian Science. Now, Patricia's healing came about just by reading the book Science and Health and knowing about the Bible. I should say that all the way through Science and Health, Bible passages and the focus on Jesus is woven through it. This is a book that's inseparable from the Bible. And she was reading that, and she had her healing not through reading the book, by reading the book lifting her to that consciousness of God and of who she was in relation to God. And that healing impact is there. Sometimes, though, you need help, right? Sometimes you need someone to reach out to and say, I'm struggling, I need a hand. And that's what a Christian Science practitioner can do. It can help pray for someone who needs help by seeing that spiritual selfhood in the other individual. And it's kind of like turning on the light in a dark place so that the light, as it did for Patricia, streams in and shows you who you truly are. But in Angie's case, she had a case where she was diagnosed with a form of pneumonia, and she was in a hospital consultant's room, and the consultant was so concerned that he not only offered her a prescription, but asked her to stay in the hospital without even going home because he thought she needed care so urgently. But the thing was, Angie was only in the hospital for the diagnosis. She wasn't really seeking treatment. And the reason was her family was so concerned about her condition, and lovingly concerned, of course, they wanted her to get that diagnosis, and she thought it was the loving thing to do that. But she did tell the consultant that she had relied on this approach to healing for decades, and that was where her confidence was. And he reluctantly let her go, but then also very generously offered a private phone number so that if she changed her mind, she could get in touch with him straight away and get shipped back into the hospital. But that wasn't what happened. She went home and she rang a Christian Science practitioner for prayerful support. She also enlisted a Christian Science nurse. And a Christian Science nurse is an experienced Christian Scientist who has nursing skills, non-medical nursing skills, but who also brings into the sick room a commitment to a spiritual awareness, a spiritual perception of the individual, which supports the healing process. So with that help, Angie actually didn't get worse. She began to get a little bit better. She got enough better that when she had something she felt she should be doing at work, which needed urgent attention, she decided to get out of bed and go to work and do that. Bad choice. She collapsed in a heap and was put into a cab and shipped back home. And when she got home, as you can imagine, all she wanted to do was lose herself in unconsciousness and go to sleep. But this thought came to read a bunch of citations on the subject of divine love from the Bible and from Science and Health, and she obediently did that. I say obediently. There was actually a lot of resistance, but she finally obediently did that. When she realized that this was probably a message from God, and so she complied. And I love the way she describes her healing. She two particular passages stood out for her. This first one is from the book of Isaiah. Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Fear thou not. And the message got through. She said, suddenly the fear began to drain away. And there was a huge amount of fear surrounding this diagnosis, but even before the diagnosis, just from the sickness itself. So that really began to open her mind in a good way. And then, double whammy, Science and Health, she read this: the depth, breadth, height, might, majesty, and glory of infinite love fill all space. That is enough. And you know, those words to me look absolutely beautiful just in black and white on paper. But when they come off the paper and they become what's in your consciousness, and you are aware of the depth, breadth, height, might, majesty, and glory of infinite love filling all space, and you're aware that that is enough, then it's not only beautiful to listen to or hear or think about, it is a beautiful reality, and it heals. And in that moment, Angie said she felt totally surrounded by love, totally immersed in love. And in that moment, every vestige of the pneumonia disappeared instantaneously. And she went back to the hospital again to at her family's request. She felt so clear that A, she had felt this presence of divine love, B, that it had resulted in the physical change. But at her family's request, and again, out of love, they were requesting that, she went and had the x-rays, and the doctor came back with the x-rays and said, there is no evidence of the pneumonia at all. Actually, the doctor articulated it more poetically, but I don't have the words in front of me at the moment. But basically, it had gone. And, you know, we were talking about this idea of the material basis of reality. Remember Jacob Neusner was saying that what Mary Baker Eddy did was to go in exactly the opposite direction of the secular Western understanding of what the foundation of everything is. And so when we're talking about healings like Patricia's and Angie's, what they have in common is that the healing agent was this understanding of God that broke through. And that is the basic core idea in Christian Science, is that when we understand our real nature as the expression of God, that can bring healing. But those healings are not the goal of Christian Science. You could almost call them the side effect. The goal is this understanding of spirit as the sole reality of existence. Sole reality of existence. So counterintuitive to the material perspectives we have grown so familiar with. And I love the way the Bible describes this reality of existence. It says, no eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard, and it has never been occurred to the human heart, all the things that God has prepared for those who love him. And it goes on to say, but God has shown us these profound and startling realities through his Spirit. The Spirit searches all things, even the deep mysteries of God. And I want to add, it's profoundly good and startlingly good realities we're talking about here. We're talking about what the Bible calls the kingdom of heaven. Not a far-off place after death, but a conscious awareness of the reality of the harmony that God has created, in which we all truly live and move and have our being, as the Apostle Paul once put it. And remember this quote? When we see this, when we see that our real individuality is so much more, and that's my definition of humility, it's going down in our self-esteem in terms of our material qualifications and all that. Not that they're not important, they matter and they're valuable, but we're all infinitely more than that. And when we catch a glimpse of that, look what Mrs. Eddy said happened to her. She said, when I would reach this tone of thought, the sick would be healed without a word. When I reached this tone, the sick would be healed without a word. And she had the track record to prove that she walked the talk. This was not theory. This is something she proved over and over again. She relates healings of cancers and healings of club feet. And not only, these are testified to by other people as well. And in the list I've given you before the end of this lecture, and those of you who are on the webcast, it will go up eventually online as well. But it includes two biographies, one that talks about Mary Baker Eddy in the social context. The other one has all the known healings listed, certainly the bulk of them. And they're very inspiring and very educational as well. So this wasn't theory. Going down in our own self-estimation in terms of who we think of ourselves as being materially and discovering who we are spiritually makes us A, open to being healed, and B, open to becoming healers. So what does it look like to be a healer? Well, Mary Baker Eddy had a beautiful way of explaining it to a student who asked her that basic question. And, you know, I think of the Bible characters. We know, for instance, not only Jesus, but many of his earliest followers healed. And as I said, there were some healings in the Old Testament. We know what they healed, and we know the circumstances in which they healed, and we might even know what they said in order to bring about the healing. We don't have a snapshot of their thoughts as they were healing. But I think in the case of Mary Baker Eddy, we do have a little snapshot of her thoughts. She said this to that student when she made her discovery, this healing discovery. I saw the love of God encircling the universe and man, filling all space. And that divine love so permeated my own consciousness that I loved with Christ-like compassion everything I saw. I saw the love of God encircling the universe and man, meaning all men, women, and children equally, and indeed all God's creatures. And that divine love so permeated my own consciousness that I loved with Christ-like compassion everything I saw. And then she says, this realization of divine love called into expression the beauty of holiness, the perfection of being, which healed and regenerated and saved all who came to me for help. You know, we might think, even if we're experienced healers, that this is the postgraduate stage and we're at the kindergarten stage. But the thing is, you know, remember this piano? Most of us in this room cannot compose music like Beethoven, right? But every one of us can see through a box with black and white keys to know that there's music there. And we can all learn how to play that piano. And we can all keep improving how we play that piano. Well, now we know there's a divine science in this book. We can all open these pages and learn of this divine science and of how to practice it. And as I said, how to be healed, how to heal our loved ones, how to heal people in our communities, and how to embrace the world in our healing thoughts. We all have things in the world we want to see changed for the better. Well, we can all embrace the world like Mrs. Eddy saw God encircling the world. Imagine if everyone in this room and everyone on the webcast just took a couple of minutes after this talk to really see that God, good, divine love, pure spirit, is encircling the world and man and every individual one of us. Could that make a difference? I think it would. Well, the divine science in this book has, for me and for many others, opened this book and showed it to be something very different to what we thought it was. And I would love everyone who maybe hasn't even read the Bible for years, or even those who have and have got a little bit stuck with what it seems to be saying, get a copy of Science and Health, open it with an open heart and read it, and it will open the pages of this book to you. It won't change a word in this book. It doesn't need to. Mrs. Eddy wasn't creating something new. She was discovering something that is already there. And one of the things, I will go back quickly to this quote that I just skipped past. I'm going to finish on this. It's just this Episcopalian minister wrote this beautiful quote. He was a contemporary of Mary Baker Eddy's, and he wrote that carol, O Little Town of Bethlehem. Does anyone like that carol? Do you know it was written for one Sunday school class for one Sunday morning originally? They had no idea what it was going to become. And it's gone around the world, translated into so many languages. But he also wrote this. He said, God has not given us vast learning to solve all the problems or unfailing wisdom to direct all the wanderings of our brothers' lives, but he has given to every one of us the power to be spiritual and by our spirituality to lift and enlarge and enlighten the lives we touch. I'm sharing that for two reasons. One is because it's absolutely beautiful. And the second is because at some point, Mary Baker Eddy scribbled next to this passage, the secret of my life is in the above. Mary Baker Eddy did what she did for all humankind. She loved her church. She loved her members. She loved Christianity. She just kept loving. There were no borders, no barriers. And she saw love encircling the globe, including all mankind. Well, it's something of an open secret now because she has written Science and Health. We can all read it. And it's based on her life. That's one of the beautiful things. When you get to know Science and Health, you realize it's written based on a life lived. None of it's theoretical. She proved every statement that is written in this book. And so I hope as you go away, you'll feel either dedicated to rereading or buying and reading or borrowing and reading Science and Health. We do have some copies here. If you don't have a copy, the local church is gifting you a copy and very happy to do that. And if you're online on the webcast, there are reading rooms in many of your areas where you can go and talk to librarians or pick up a copy of the book or getting other helpful resources. But thank you for listening. I'm just going to finish with one last quote because we talked about National Women's History Month. Well, the National Women's Book Association of the United States of America talked about Science and Health as one of 75 books that have changed the world. And it certainly changed my world. I believe it can change the world of anyone who reads it with an open heart. And I do believe as we read it with an open heart, the world is changed. Thank you.